work do you do, Bill?
I rob stagecoaches.
I know about where you've been. I frankly don't have much use for your kind.
You, Nat?
Yep. I think we're being robbed.
You're being robbed.
I'm much less worldly than you think.
Are you indeed?
Man, my age to future don't mean too much unless you're maybe thinking about next week.
I realize something about myself. I've got ambitions in me that just won't quit.
Can you say a little bit about the 4K restoration? Why did you feel necessary to have a 4K restoration for the film?
As technology advances, we get better and better quality, and people want to see films in the best available format. And, you know, we've had Blu-ray has been the state of the art in recent years. But 4K is available, and since we were restoring it, we went to that format because probably that will be good for some years, hopefully. Mm-hmm.
The running of the film seems to be a little bit shortened because in the Wikipedia it says that the original version was about 115 minutes and this one is about 130. Which part has been removed and why?
Well, I'm not quite sure. I should talk to the guys there. Nothing has been touched. The film, as far as I know, is 93 minutes long. Mm-hmm. It's always been 93. So I don't know what the 113 is, but no scene has been cut and no part of any scene has been cut. Mm-hmm. So that's a mystery to me.
And in regards to the film, original film, who did first introduce you to the idea of making a film on this topic? Was it you that suggested the topic to the film director, or was it the director that approached you?
No, it was the director who approached me. The director, Philip Borsos, as a child, or at least as a teenager, grew up in the city where Bill Miner robbed his first train.
So
he was, you know, well known to everybody living there, right? Oh yeah, this is Bill Miner. Yeah, he robbed the Canadian Pacific Railway just, just outside of town. And so Philip grew up with this mythology in the back of his mind. And when he wanted to make a feature film, his first, he wanted to make it on that subject.
And how difficult was it to make a Western film in Canada?
I like to call it a Northwestern, just because that gives it the slightly Canadian part to it. But, you know, everyone was very enthusiastic and helpful. The most difficult thing in terms of, you know, the materiel, the technical side of it, were the logistics of the trains, of the period trains that are in the film, because they had to be brought from one part of one train that came from Oregon, another from Washington State, and the others were in British Columbia. But when you want to bring a period train, an antique train, from one place to another, obviously it has to be by rail, and it cannot go in the middle of a modern train. It has to be it can be attached on the back end, because if it's in the middle, the train it could break, and the train could be in real trouble. So it has to be. Mm. So anytime you want a passenger car and it's coming from Oregon or something, it's quite a deal. And the same with the engines, steam engines. But it was like any period film. You're looking for authentic costumes and props and locations. And Philip Orsos was very particular about this kind of thing. There's one scene in the film, which is what we call the arrest scene, where Bill Miner is arrested by the mounted police. And that scene was shot in the exact place it happened. And the words spoken by all the actors, the dialogue, was taken word for word from the court transcript. So it's as, you know, close to the real thing as you could get. And it's, whenever I see that scene, I just think, wow, that is, you know, I'm seeing the real thing.
And coming back to the questions of, do you want to make it real? How real and how hard you try to make it real? For example, the ending of the film, is it also based on the truest story?
Yes. Yes. Bill Miner, the end of the film is based on the true story. Miner and his two accomplices were convicted of train robbery and went to the British Columbia Penitentiary at New Westminster, and he escaped. Mm-hmm. And not everything is known about that, but one historian said that he had found a boat and rowed, you know, out of sight. So mm-hmm. That's the end of the film. But that's not the end of Bill Miner. Bill Miner went to other places. He came, possibly went to, we don't know that he went to Europe or Chicago with Kate, the lady. That was, you know, that was rumored to have happened. And so we put it that way in the film as a kind of rumor. But the romance part of the film is not perhaps historical. We know that he had a relationship with a woman in that town while he was hiding out. It was said that it was the photographer, and the screenwriter took it from there. So that's not based on you know, historical accuracy. It's a little bit of you know, storytelling on the part of the screenwriter. Miner himself ended up robbing a train in Georgia and went to prison there. He escaped and he went into a swamp and was surrounded by the dogs and that sort of thing. And he got swamp fever and died in the prison infirmary.
Okay.
He never gave up. He never stopped.
Mm-hmm. In terms of financial aspects of the film, how did you raise the fund for the film?
In the early 1980s in Canada, the government allowed films to be financed by public offering on the basis of a particular tax structure that was called it's everywhere, capital cost allowance, and it applied to only a few particular things that investors could write off their investment in the first year of their investing the money. And so we did a public offering, which was very expensive, and we were not, you know, for example, it takes lawyers and stockbrokers and everybody to do that, and I'm not any of those things, but I was a young producer, and so, you know, I got a lawyer who knew, and our executive producer knew stockbrokers, and so David Brady, so we did it, and we managed to, with quite a lot of difficulty, to close the deal after the film had been shot. So we had to interim finance, so we had to borrow money to shoot the film and then sell these, I guess they were called units in the film, like shares.
The performance of Richard Farnsworth is mesmerizing. How was he picked for this role? Do you remember any memory from of working with him?
Yes, I do, very much so. And Richard had, at that point, he wasn't that well known, but he had been nominated for an Oscar for a movie called Comes a Horseman with Jane Fonda and Jason Robards. And he was so authentic and real in that film that our director noticed him there. He he'd also been in a film called Tom Horn with Steve McQueen, and he was wonderful there as well. There was a time earlier when Philip, the director, was interested in having Harry Dean Stanton, the American actor, play Bill Miner, and it so happened that he was signed to One from the Heart by Francis Coppola at the same time as we were going to do this film. And we went, the director and I and the writer, we went to L.A., to Hollywood, and we met Richard. And, boy, you know, it was absolutely perfect. And what we enjoyed later on when the two of them were in The Straight Story by David Lynch as the two brothers who ended up in the final scene of the movie. Mm. And we there they were, the two of them together, mm. Harry Dean and Richard.
Mm, yeah. Yes, I remember that scene very well. And the film is now considered as one of the essentials in Canadian cinema. Have you noticed a change in the way that the film was evaluated during the past decades? If yes, in what way?
Well, I'm not absolutely sure who's doing that. I would say that the Toronto International Film Festival and Cinematheque Ontario, I seem to me to be the group that does a lot of that sort of evaluating of things. Mm. But, you know, what happens every year or so, you know, there are new films that come out and the list changes, the top 10 films or whatever, or the essential films aren't always in vogue, or they come back or they leave, or so I don't really know. I don't really know quite how those evaluations are actually made, but I know they get a panel of critics and filmmakers to do that.
And how do you think about the film and its relevance to the contemporary audience?
Well, it's funny when the film won the Canadian you know, Genie, the Academy Award in Canada for Best Picture. I had to go up and get the statue and, you know, say thank you to the Academy. And I said, you know, I can really relate to Bill Miner robbing the train because you know, in this economy, I can really relate to that. And the idea of someone having the skills to do that and wanting to continue to do it is quite an interesting thing. But I suppose the change of technology, what was happening when this film was being made, was when at the turn of the 20th century, from the 19th to the 20th, was the whole idea of machinery and you know, the not the Industrial Revolution, but just the invention of machines. And you recall the Gray Fox in one of the very early scenes. This guy's got this mechanical apple peeler, and you know, technology has been revolutionized again. Obviously, in the last 40 years, but in the last 20 years, we've had you know, a lot of digital communications, which has changed everything. There is that comparison or that kind of connection, mm-hmm. because Bill Miner is a character who isn't really changing into the modern world. He's from a former time, and he, you know, he maintains his dignity and you know, and his gentlemanliness while he's doing it, and it's quite an interesting portrayal. But that's about all I can see. I think the film is universal. It's a universal love story. It's someone who keeps on going, even finds love late, and is someone who finds the value in living every day. He's a pretty amazing guy.
You served as the chair of the board of TV Ontario. How was that experience? Are you still involved with them?
No. Thank you for asking about that. It's one of the, you know, one of the contributions of that I'm you know, proudest of. I've always loved TVO, and I loved TVO from the year it started in 1970, watching L.W. Yost and Saturday night at the movies. And I used to, you know, a lot of the films that are really important, particularly American films, I think, you know, I saw on TVO. And so it was quite a kind of education for me. So the chance to contribute as the board chair for 13 years was great. But the main thing is, it was wonderful to, you know, help and do the things that you have to do to keep TVO going along and financed and supported by government and watched by millions of Ontarians, and both children and adults. So I'm a fan of TVO. So it's nice to do something that you like that for a place that you're a real fan of.
Compared to the French Canadian filmmakers, the majority of filmmakers in English part of Canada prefer to test their chance in U.S. after becoming famous in Canada. You also followed the same trend and decided after a while to work on Hollywood. What do you think are the major reasons behind this decision for most of Canadian filmmakers, especially in English section part?
I think, are you asking about, you know, filmmakers going to Hollywood?
Yes, yes. Yes,
like me doing some Hollywood films.
Yes, yes.
I see. Right. Well, you know, if I can answer from a personal point of view, and then I'll try to talk about everybody else. But of course, you know, I think that the you know, if you're interested in Canada and its culture, and that's where I am and have been all my life. I only did the films that were we took certain films to Hollywood because they were too expensive. One was a Christmas film, but they were Canadian films. And The Grey Fox was distributed by United Artists, and then when MGM took over United Artists, then MGM UA. And we did one with Disney and one with 20th Century Fox, but they were Canadian films, and they were, you know, qualified in the point system and whatnot for to be Canadian. The other type of Canadian filmmaker, and an example of that would be James Cameron, for example. James Cameron's a guy who, you know, the dream for him was to go straight to Hollywood, not necessarily to make Canadian films, but to make, you know, international movies. Mm-hmm. And so he went and he didn't stop in at home to make films here first. He just went straight off and did that. In earlier times, before there was the opportunity to make Canadian films, somebody like Norman Jewison went to make films in the U.S. really because there wasn't anything at home, and he initially went to do television shows in New York, and was so successful that he quickly went into a movie directing career. But I'm not sure if I'm getting to your question or not.
And you think that the major reason, for example, was mostly like James Cameron directors want to be more international, or it was not, for example, the infrastructure at hand to continue working in Canada?
I'm not sure, but people who, you know, the movies, people who love the movies, we all love the movies, and Canadians are, you know, the cinema of most Canadians is Hollywood cinema. Mm-hmm. You know, the Canadian movie is still, you know, something that isn't an everyday thing. The good ones come along. You know, there aren't the movie theaters where we can't go right now, but the movie theaters on any given night don't have mainly Canadian films in them. They have Hollywood films. So we grow up on Hollywood films. That's the exciting, flashy, bright, and sexy movie experience. That and so somebody like Cameron specifically, but there are others, and it applies to our actors as well. You want to go to the biggest, best place, you know. Where they do it at the highest level, and that's what some of them do. And an actor, a very early film I produced, Dan Aykroyd was in it. But, you know, when, and then he went to Saturday Night Live, mm-hmm. just in the chorus. But pretty soon, you know, Ivan Reitman, who had done a couple of Canadian films, but he is still doing U.S. studio movies. And because that's where the, you know, that's where they do it in the biggest possible way.
And you mentioned the fact that you were lucky to get financial support from the government in 1980. I suppose that that system has changed, yes?
Yes, it's a great shame, Amir. The this is a great disappointment to me. That particular system called the capital cost allowance was a wonderful way to finance. The government would lose some taxes from it, but it was a great way of getting our cinema going. But what happened fairly quickly was it was abused by lots of, you know, not necessarily deliberately, but some sort of a lot of films that were sort of semi-Hollywood films that weren't very good were made, and the purpose of it was kind of compromised and lost. And it wasn't long before the government said, what are we doing this for? And so it was, you know, it was canceled. And it was a great way to do it. I did two films that way. One was The Grey Fox and one was My American Cousin. And they're very, very Canadian films. And I believe at least that, you know, I was part of using the system for what it was meant to produce.
And the new tax system that, for example, returns back parts of the labor tax is not some the same, no? Is there something totally different?
Yes, it's something different. Although it is another way of using tax money that would come to the government and instead go into a film. But it's not a way to completely finance a film. The tax credits, labor tax credits, are you know, an ingredient of the financing of the film, not the overall financing. But still, very, very helpful, I'm sure.
The new version is supposed to be released in virtual theaters. How do you feel about this? And especially, how do you think about the future of cinema after COVID-19?
Well, firstly, about the Grey Fox. You know, The Grey Fox is a beautiful film to look at. And, you know, the director and almost all the other artists from the film have now passed away. And, you know, I've been for some time thinking, well, how can we preserve the beauty of this film? And so, you know, to find that technology has advanced to the point where, you know, the film is almost more beautiful than it was in the first place is really exciting. There are those who, you know, a lot of film guys love film itself, the actual, you know, analog part of the physical part of a film that has a density and frames that are passing through the gate 24 times a second, because there's a kind of tactile and density to it that just can't be recreated, you know, electronically or digitally. But in the same way as sound, a lot of people, they're music people who love discs, who love, you know, what they call vinyl. Mm-hmm. That's great but you can't preserve that forever. And so we were already at the stage where our film elements on The Grey Fox were 40 years old, and even though they had been stored and protected, the element from which we did the transfer to digital had already faded. Its detail was there, but its colors were getting lost. We're definitely fading, and that would be an ongoing thing. So imagine how great it is to really bring it back. It's really a thrill for me to see it. The second part is to do with. Well, the question really is, what will happen to the movies now? Something was already happening, as you know, which was that you know, the way we watch films was starting to be on our big screens at home and Netflix and so on and so forth. I mean, it started with HBO and Showtime many years ago, but Netflix is a further extension of that. And, you know, the great writing today is, you know, there's great movie writing, but a lot of it is on these series that are on Netflix and many other channels as well. So that's already been happening, where the cinema is stressed, the actual business of going to the movies. That business has been under stress for some years, you know, for many years really. And the COVID-19, the pandemic, is going to really, really put it in, really against the wall. I'm somebody who likes to go to the movies, to the theater, to see a movie. You know, I love it. I love being in the big room and, you know, with other people. And I don't like going when it's completely packed full of people. Mm-hmm. But I love to see a movie in the theater. What an experience that is. I don't know how that's going to be managed. I can't believe that there will be as many theaters staying open when the smoke clears on the pandemic. You know, the real estate's too valuable. People will have got used to staying home and watching at home. It's sad in one way, but it's change. You know, the attempt to make the cinema unique by meaning as a place to go by having gimmicks like earthquake, you know, moving seats and all sorts of 3D, for example, although I imagine that can be, I don't know, can you have 3D at home? I'm not sure of that. But all of those sorts of things haven't really proven to be, to have held on to the audience for, you know, for very long. It is the film itself, it is the story, it is the art of the actual cinema, and it's the way the film's made that is what holds the audience. We have these big, big screens that are so beautiful, and, you know, it's a joy to watch a movie. During COVID-19, I am watching a movie every day and choosing one to watch and looking forward to it. You know, I watch them at night, but it's something I look forward to every day. So I know the experience has moved. I'm sorry, I'm going on too long, I think.